28 in 1966, I sat in a pew just like you all are sitting at St. Mark's Church in Houston as I was ordained a deacon. And from that time, that was the beginning of a growing and exciting time of ordained ministry. And as I look back on that time, my diaconate was short. In fact, it should have been a lot longer because I needed to learn so much more. But you know, when I was at the ripe old age of 25, when I was ordained, and just out of seminary, my Lord, I knew everything. And I knew enough to actually run a good medium-sized parish on my own. And that lasted about 30 seconds into my first job. And I realized that I needed to be a deacon a lot longer. Well, also, there's a little known fact for you young ladies that have asked me to preach, that I may hold the Guinness record for the shortest time a priest has ever had a deacon. I had a deacon for less than 24 hours. Sadly, the deacon and his family moved into the assistant rectory in another diocese where I was serving, and in a short time, he left his wife and his family and his job, and he headed north. And I don't want to go into the details, but I happened to be also the president of the standing committee at the time, and it was my job to be a part of his deposition. So, you know, after that incident, you know, while I served in that diocese, I was never given an opportunity to have another deacon. In fact, I had to leave that diocese and go to another diocese. I've had the good fortune, though, this is on the better side of deacon things, I've had the good fortune of having at least 10 deacons as a parish priest. And it's wonderful because I was able to get them right out of seminary. They had such wonderful new ideas, and they were smart, and they were fresh, and they brought new energy to the job. And I learned a lot from them. I learned a great deal from those deacons over those years. You know, our scripture readings today give us some very good ideas about the role of a deacon. In fact, if we read those over and over again, we could really end the sermon right there, because they're so full of good information. One from Ecclesiasticus. You know, it's God's word will be heard through you, through your teaching, through your prayers, through your words. And the one from Timothy tells us that we are first tested, as you all have been for a number of years in your ongoing education. And you have passed, and now you are set to be ordained. But it also says more about what you are to do. And then the two alternate gospels from Luke give us a wonderful reminder that we are always need to be ready for the Son of Man who will appear in our lives. And again, a deacon is one who serves others. As early as the 1550 Book of Common Prayer in the Church of England, the ordinal, we have the church spelling out what is expected of a deacon. And it's in just a little while, our bishop will read from that prayer book the charge that will tell what each of you ordinands are about to get into. And I must tell you that, and really warn you, that the church, through the ages, uses a word that describes this ministry. And of course, you all know what that word is. is the word service, or being a servant. And that's how we begin our ordination and our ordination service. And those of us who are ordained, whether it's a deacon or a priest or a bishop, we still go back to that word service and serve. Because that's what God has called each one of us to do, to carry out. I want to share some thoughts with you about your new venture, your new adventure in ministry, your new lifestyle that you are embarking on today. Something is going to happen to you in this church, like the mysterious thing that happened to you years ago when God called you into ministry. You can't really explain that. I know you've tried to explain that to the Commission on Ministry and to your bishops, but it's still a mystery. How could God call me? And then, what happens here tonight will change you forever. And once you are ordained, you are ordained for life. There's no retirement in ordination. Yes, there are some retired clergy here, and I is one of them, and I see some others out there, but we still serve. And once you put that collar on and have those hands laid on you, your life is going to change forever. As God begins this shaping and molding today, I think four thoughts about the deacon stand out in our today's reading. First, we're told that God speaks to you, and God speaks through you. That's a very humbling thing for most of us. Behind these readings, there is a message to you to continue to study, to continue to listen, and to listen to God as you hear God speaking through those words in Scripture and your studies. And I know when I finally finished seminary, I was so glad to be out of the classroom. I mean, golly, that was because I had the good fortune or the bad fortune of going from high school to college to seminary to ordination. And I think that through your study, you will hear God's voice speaking to you. And just remind yourself that you are on a journey along with many others. And that part of the journey is letting the Holy Spirit speak to you and speak through you and to guide you. Second, as we consider thoughts about being a deacon, we find that you will also speak for God. That is clear in the ordination service and in our scripture. Certainly the gospel reading and the words of the ordination liturgy and from Paul's letter to Timothy or 1 Timothy and even Ecclesiasticus, they talk about that aspect of speaking for God. And there's a pastoral aspect and of service when they use those strong words, the word servant. As a deacon, you are about the work of a servant. It is lived out as you share in the lives of the people that are under your charge or in your pastoral care. This ordination makes it abundantly clear that you are to serve all God's people, especially the poor, the weak, the sick, the lonely, the disenfranchised, the marginal. You are to do your part in meeting their needs, and you are also to speak in their behalf as you bring their concerns and their hopes to the church and to the world. You know, some of my most satisfying moments in ministry happened during that time when I was a deacon, and when my primary responsibility was to minister to those who were under me and in my charge, or that's what my boss told me, you look after this group and this group and this group. And and some of those were some wonderful times with knowing that God was working in me and through me, and having those people also help me to understand what God wanted me to do. So we are an advocate with those people. We are an advocate for those people. And it seems like in my waking hours, I was ministering directly to people. And as we learn, we are blessed by those same people, the things that they give us in return. I also learned a very important lesson that I know you already know. Part of the role of a deacon is to raise up leadership among your people. The responsibility is not just to care for them, but to also enable these folks to become disciples, and that they can carry out the ministry that both of us have been called to do by Christ. So, yes, you are to serve, but you're also to raise up that leadership. And because of who you are, as I know you, you all have that ability to help work with people and to help them move into those leadership positions. You've heard from clergy, I know, who tell you that one of their regrets is not spending enough time with their families. Well, in 1 Timothy, as well as in the prayer book, our ordained clergy are called to live out God's love by having time for yourself and your families. I think that's an underlying theme in that Timothy passage. One of the significant ways that you are to live out your faith is to be with your own families. And it's very easy to keep busy with the vineyard, in the vineyard with others, and to neglect your own. And I know each one of us with a collar on can confess that we have been there and we have not been as attentive to our family as we should have been. Not only through your preaching and your teaching do you model Christ's love, but just as a reminder to you and to all of us, and to the laity, we model Christ's love to the world through our life within our family, whatever family that is. And I know that is a thing where each one of us gets strength from our families and to help us to continue to serve even when things get really tough on our end in the quote professional unquote part. And finally, I want to remember the words of St. Paul to the church at Corinth, which was not one of our readings, but it is so important to mention this and to remind us tonight about this. Paul spoke very strongly about gifts that God has given each one of you. God has given each one of you different gifts. And I want to remind you that God not only called you to be a deacon, but God called you to use those gifts to carry out that ministry. Don't underestimate or don't downplay the gifts that God has given you. They are God-given, and God expects you to use them for the betterment of the kingdom and the mission of the church. And like anything in life, when we fail to use something, it gets dull and sometimes disappears. And we also have to remember that we're not given all of the gifts for ministry. And some of them Paul lists. And one of the things that I always tell confirmation classes, and some of you have heard this before, but when I was in junior high school and I was in the junior high choir, after the first 6 weeks, the teacher came to me and said, for the next programs, Rayford, you need to mouth the words. That is a gift that God didn't give me. And for many years, I felt badly about that. I tried to change that or do something about it, and it didn't work. And so I've accepted the fact that that's not a gift I have, but God has given me other gifts. And so think about what God has given you that you can use and exercise in your ministry. God expects you to use them for the mission of the church, and likewise in life, when we fail to use those gifts, they get dull. So, Lisa and Lynne, God has brought you to this point in the history of your journey. And we are here this night, this great crowd, this great congregation, to support you, not only tonight, but what we said earlier, that we will support you in this ministry. God has set you apart forever. God will continue to be with you, even when you question or you wonder, is God really around, or God, did you make a mistake? Should I really be doing this? No. God is going to continue to be with you. And we're so proud of you and your accomplishments and excited for what you will do in Christ's name. And a final word to you and to those you will serve as an ordained minister in Christ's one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. A bit of advice from one of the giants in our recent past, written in the late 1930s, early 1940s, when only men were ordained into the ministry in England. The late Archbishop William Temple, a bishop of a diocese, used to gather his newly ordained clergy each year and hold a retreat for them. One of the main things that he would point out to them was that they were all hirelings. And whether they would ever become true shepherds would depend on them and on the type of relationship that they wanted to have with their people and on the pastoral relationship that their people allowed them to establish. And so to the congregation that's gathered here and to those that you will serve over the years, he went on to say, and this is not exactly his quotes, but if your minister is to become something more than a hireling for you, you must avoid a path and rut of thinking that some lay people quite easily move into. They do something that tends to cancel out a person's ministry. They look upon that person as just fulfilling a job, even though it's a somewhat specialized one. Or they cancel out that person's ministry to them by commenting, by saying, well, after all, we pay that person for it. A clergy person is not in the ministry for the money. And even bishops aren't in the ministry for money. And if they were, they would do something. If they wanted to make money, they would do something else. So we know that you're not. You're here because God called you to be here. And so one of my words to the congregations is to be sensitive to these newly ordained persons and not cancel their ministry out by saying, well, they should have done it this way because we pay them to do that, or that's not the way so-and-so did it. And so tonight, as we gather and celebrate your ordination, we know that we're here, we've said some words, and we're here to, in a way, not just pat you on the back, but to give you a hug and say, we're so happy and proud of you. But God's Holy Spirit is going to do something and is doing something special, as God's Spirit did a long time ago when God called Lynne and Lisa and said, come, be one of my spokespersons, be one of my servants. So bless you all tonight. And we look forward to seeing you all as you continue your ministry.